special message. I love Super Bowl weekend. I love the commercials. I love watching the game. I'm a little bit sad that the 49ers are not in the game. I know Raiders fans, you're sad as well. So we're all sad, but we're happy that it's Super Bowl Sunday. Now, to get us started today, I'd like to do a little pop quiz, and the quiz goes something like this. So I want to throw out the question. It's an A, B, or C option. Sunnyvale, we'd like for you to participate. Those of you online, you can also participate if you're in a coffee shop or at home. We're going to give you three options, and you get to choose A, B, or C. Now, the question is, listen to the question. I'll give you the three options, and then on the second go-around, you can choose which of the three options you think is correct. Where is it okay? Here's the question. Where is it okay for a man to hug another man who is a complete stranger? Is it A, the DMV? Is it B, In-N-Out? Or is it C, a professional football game? Okay, one more time, go back through it. Those of you who think it's A, DMV, raise your hand. All right, nobody's that crazy. Those of you who think it's okay, right before you get your chocolate milkshake, to go give a stranger a hug, B, In-N-Out, raise your hand. All right, those of you that think it's C, raise the hands up, a professional sporting event. Okay, everybody got it correct. Look around. We all know at a professional sporting event, people go crazy. I heard recently that the same amount of dopamine that is released in the brain of a player is the amount of dopamine that's released into a person's brain who's watching the game. So a lot of times we think we're on the field, but buddy, we're actually in the stands or we're watching the game. It's amazing to me how crazy people are about their sports teams. And one of the things that never ceases to amaze me is how, especially men, use this operative word, we, whenever they're discussing their sports team. Have you ever noticed this? Like, we're going to the Super Bowl this year. We won the game. It's looking good for us. Have you ever noticed that? Buddy, there is no we in it. It's you and they. There are a lot of distinctions between you and them. A few body fat percentages is one of the distinctions. A few million dollars a year. You pay to watch the game. They get paid for the game, millions of dollars. So there's a big distinction. Now, somebody once said that football is 22 players on the field in desperate need of rest with 60,000 fans in the stand in desperate need of exercise. Is that not true? And Super Bowl Sunday is that it tops it all, where there will be millions and millions and millions of people around a TV stuffing their face while there were 22 people on the field playing the game. You know, oftentimes churches are like that too. It's a disproportionate percentage of people that do all the praying, all the serving, all the giving, all the inviting. And we started South Bay 6 years ago. Next week, it will be our six-year anniversary. We started 6 years ago under the premise, what if we could be different? What if our church could have a higher percentage of people that are in the game? And we've had that from the very beginning, that we've had a great number of people that bought into our vision and our mission, that they moved from the stands to the field. But as our churches continue to grow and we have more people who are coming through our doors, it's become increasingly important to take some time for us to ask the question, what would it look like for those of us who are in the stands as spectators to move to the field as participants, to go from consumer to contributor, to be a part of the work that God is doing through our church, through his local church here in the Bay Area. So I have two hopes. Number one, if you are on the field, if you're in the game, you're serving in children's ministry, you're hosting life groups, you're investing in the lives of our students, we hope that for those of you who are on the field, you'll be like, yeah, preach it, go get them. You'll feel encouraged as we talk about moving from the stands to the field. And those of you who are in the stands, spectating, watching, we hope that today you'll take that next step to be engaged. Now, if you're a guest with us, we welcome you. This is a great weekend for you to be here because you're going to get to hear our heart for you, and you're going to get to hear why our people are so passionate about what we do as a church. So we're going to look at a story found in Mark chapter 2. If you have a Bible, you can turn there. This is a story where we're going to see three different groups of people. We're going to see some people who are in the game, and we're going to see a couple other groups of people who are watching the story unfold. This is an eyewitness account from the life of Jesus, recorded verbatim or recorded through the lips of Peter, written down by a guy named Mark. Peter was one of Jesus' initial 12 disciples or apostles who would travel with him from town to town, and he would tell this story afterwards and the significance that it had had on him as he watched it unfold. We're going to go directly to verse number 3 after I share the context of what happened in this story. Jesus has come back home after traveling through the area. He's done his first tour of ministry. He's healed people. He's taught large groups of people. He's gone out. And then the story happens that he comes home. He's actually in his home. We see from the context that Jesus had a home that he would do a lot of his ministry out of. He'd travel, then he would come back. And when Jesus comes back to his house, there are so many people that gather together to hear Jesus teach. And they want to get as close as possible to Jesus, to hear his teaching, to see the miracles that he's going to perform. And in the story, we're going to watch one man get healed, and we're going to see something beautiful unfold as a group of people contribute to one man being healed. We're going to pick it up in Mark chapter 2, verse number 3, as it comes on the screen. It says, "Some men came bringing to him a paralytic carried by the four of them." Now, when they come into the room, there are so many people. In fact, the first couple of verses says that the room is so crowded that nobody else can get into the room. In verse number 4, it says this, "Since they could not get him to Jesus, the crowd parted. They took the paralyzed man directly to Jesus, and Jesus healed him." No, that's not what the story says. Some of you are looking at it, you're like, no. Imagine, though, if that were the story. Actually, what happens is when the friends bring the man to Jesus who cannot walk, they get the man to Jesus, and there's a crowd that's in the way. There's a crowd that's standing between the one who needs healing and the one who can give healing. And if you're taking notes, we're going to look at the first group of people in the story, which is those who are consumers. The consumer in this story loves the work of Jesus. They want to see his healings. They want to hear his teachings. They want to watch the ministry unfold. They are simply consuming as Jesus is teaching. But when the friends bring the paralyzed man to Jesus, they can't get him to Jesus because of the consumers, because they're standing in the way. They're not noticing the fact that this man who can't walk is on his way to Jesus. They are simply engaged, not paying attention to the needs of those around them. They're a consumer. And isn't it interesting how we have consumers both in the stories of Jesus and in our modern day reality? That so often this consumer mindset is what is drilled into us by our culture. Did you know when you watch the Super Bowl today and there are all these cool ads with frogs from Geico and different beer commercials, that there is $180 billion that will have been spent on advertising over the last 12 months. That means that every single day when you pull up your phone and you're reading through the news or you download an app and there are all these different advertising ads that scroll on your phone, that there is message after message after message, $180 billion worth, that is feeding into your perspective of how you see yourself and how you see what you have. And the mentality that we have in our society in terms of being taught to be consumers, we are taught that there is a gap between what we have and who we are and what we need. And we start to think, if I could just get a new car, I'd be more satisfied. If I just had a little bit bigger of a house, we felt okay with our house until we saw the ad. We felt okay with our spouse until we saw the commercial. We felt okay with our kids. We felt okay until we were fed some information that led us to believe that there was a shortage. And consequently, we start to see life through the lens of a consumer. Yelp is very helpful for us in this, isn't it? That we go to a place, we rate it, we give it 1, 2, 3, or 4, or 5 stars based upon our experience. We're consumers. And the problem so often, and I believe one of the greatest problems facing the American church, is we take our consumer-driven reality, our consumer-driven mindset, and we apply it to the church. And we love the church and we love Jesus as long as the church and Jesus meet our preferences. As long as the music is what I like. You know, one Sunday it's great, one Sunday it's bad, one Sunday the food's good, one Sunday the food's bad. And we have this tendency to apply a consumer-driven mindset into the way that we look at God as well. So we think oftentimes that God, we might not say it, we might not post it on our blogs, but we internally sometimes think it, that God is sitting up in heaven thinking about how to make my life a little bit easier, how to make my life a little bit more convenient. When in reality, this consumer-driven mindset is often the mindset that prevents us from experiencing maturity in a spiritual sense, that so many of us find ourselves stuck because we've been fed a lie. We've started seeing ourselves as consumers, and the same way that there is a consumer in the story, there is a consumer in our generation, and there is a consumer inside of every single one of us. And what Jesus would do with the crowd is he would take their focus and he would get their focus off of themselves, and he would begin over the course of time to help people see that life is experienced. Joy is experienced when life is given away. And here's the consumer standing between Jesus and the one who needs healing. But there's another category of people that we're going to see in this story. It doesn't stop with the consumer. The story continues. It says, some men came to him bringing a paralytic carried by the four of them. Since they could not get him to Jesus because of the crowd, they made an opening in the roof above Jesus, and after digging through it, lowered the mat that the man was lying on. Now, think about this for a second. Here's this guy. They can't get him to Jesus, so they have to climb up the side of a house. They have to dig through a roof, and after they dig through a roof, they start lowering this guy on a mat. They overcome every barrier that stands between their friend and Jesus. There's initiative to get their friend to Jesus, but there's persistence. That they're willing to climb a wall, they're willing to dig through a roof, they are willing to do whatever it takes to see their friend get healed. We have a value here at South Bay. We say, we are willing to do whatever it takes to reach those who are far from God. And there has to be this persistence, this passion that drives us to overcome busyness, to overcome fear, to overcome embarrassment, to overcome whatever barrier stands between our friends experiencing the hope, the life, the peace that only Jesus can give. And here these men, they get their friend to Jesus, they're lowering down on the mat, and then we see in verse number 5, it says this, that Jesus looks up to them, notices their faith, and he says to the paralyzed man, son, your sins are forgiven. Now, Mark points out, some teachers of the law. These are the guys that know the law backwards and forward. These are also known as Pharisees. They're sitting there in the story at Jesus' house. You would think that a Pharisee who's a teacher of the law, when the Son of God comes, they want to learn. They want to grow. They want to watch it. They want to get as much as they can from the Son of God. But when the Pharisees are there, when the religious leaders are there watching Jesus as he forgives the sin of this paralyzed man, it says this, that the Pharisees or teachers of the law who were sitting there started thinking to themselves, why does this fellow talk like that? He's blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone? And the second category that we see in this passage of scripture is the critic. We have the consumer first that stands between the person who needs healing and Jesus. And the second group is the critic. The consumer watches the work as it unfolds without participating. The critic judges the work as it unfolds without participating. And here the religious leaders are spiritualizing their concern, spiritualizing their judgment. If this guy knew, if this guy really was a true religious leader, nobody can forgive sins but God alone. Who does this man think that he is? They're criticizing the work of God. They're criticizing the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords as he forgives the soul of this man and restores him to who God had created him to be. You know, we all have a little bit of a critic inside of us, don't we? I think it's analogous to the armchair quarterback. You ever done this before? You're watching the football game. You love Kaepernick until he throws 8 interceptions in one game. I get it. But what is crossing the line is when we start to say stuff like, man, I wouldn't have thrown it to that guy. I would have thrown it to that guy. Yeah, you would have. With a 350-pound guy running at you with 3% body fat at 30 miles an hour, you would have had the clarity of mind to think I would have thrown it to that guy. I would have kicked a field goal. I wouldn't have gone for it on fourth down. I would have gone for it. I wouldn't have kicked the field goal. I would have. You ever done that before? Moment of honesty. It's okay. Raise your hand. You've done that. Sunnyvale, you can raise your hand. There is a critic inside of all of us. But you know, the difference between the critic and somebody who actually makes a difference is simply that the critic stands on the sidelines in their judgment. The one who makes a difference says, I'm willing to get in the game and not just be a part of pointing out the problem. You know how much wisdom, how much knowledge, how much information it really takes to be able to point out when things are wrong? I mean, anybody, any fool can recognize that things don't go right. But it takes somebody who truly has knowledge and understanding, not just to point out what is out of alignment and wrong, but actually to do something about it, to say, I'm not just going to criticize. I'm going to get in the game. I'm going to get on the field to make a difference with my life. You know, South Bay, we've had a phenomenal run here as a church. In terms of gossip and judgment, a lot of churches deal with division. They deal with this cancer of people talking bad about one another and talking bad about church leadership. God has really protected our church as a whole from the beginning. In terms of gossip, we have a group of people that value honesty, that talk through problems. We don't all see everything all the way together all the time. We're not always in agreement on every single decision. In fact, we don't have an assumption at our church that everybody's going to agree on everything. In fact, my wife and I have been married for 11 years, and I still have to convince her sometimes that she's wrong. We don't agree on everything all the time. Just kidding about that. But the reality is, anytime you get two people together, you're not going to see eye to eye on everything. That's healthy. That's good. Anytime there's a marriage, there's a church, there's a life group where everybody sees it, everybody sees it the exact same way, that's a cult. That's not healthy. But the reality is, whenever we disagree, there's a way to deal with our disagreements. And the way that we deal with our disagreements is we go directly to the source of the problem. And not only do we go directly to the source of the problem, but we say, I'm willing to do something about it. So we have this little phrase here at South Bay. When somebody comes with a criticism about the church, we say, awesome, you just signed up to solve the problem. And that's what we're saying, that it's something to be in the stands and throw our popcorn and throw trash at the people on the field, but it's another to say, I see a problem on the field, and I'm willing to get down out of the stands and be part of the solution. So don't just complain about the piece of trash when you walk by it. Pick the piece of trash up. Don't just complain that the line at Bay Kids is too long to get your kids out. Sign up to be a part of the team that helps people check their kids out. Don't just complain that there's not a hot enough coffee for you. Be a part of the team that makes the hot coffee. There's a difference between the critic who's in the stands and the person who's on the field with knuckles that are bloody, an elbow with dirt all over them, and tears flowing down their face as they are passionate for a vision, that they are engaged in the mission. And my question for you today is, where are you in your journey? Are you a consumer? Are you a critic? Or are you this third group of people that we see in the story? Now watch as this story concludes what happens as Jesus, in his spirit, recognizes the criticism. It says, immediately Jesus knew in his spirit that this is what they were thinking in their hearts. And he said to them, why are you thinking these things? Jesus is the guy that you don't just want to have erroneous thoughts around because he can read your mind. So he's reading their minds. Which is easier to say to the paralytic? Your sins are forgiven, or to say, get up, take your mat, and walk. But that you may know, the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins. Jesus is making a very powerful statement here. He's saying, I'm not just a great teacher. I'm not just a healer. I'm the Son of Man. I'm God who's come down in human flesh. And I haven't just come to help people who've been blind for a few years see. I haven't just come to bring strength to the legs of a man who's paralyzed. I have come to bring life and life abundantly. I've come to restore what's been broken. I've come to bring hearts back to their heavenly Father. I've come to bring joy, hope, peace to those who are in despair, to those who are living in anxiety and apart from the life that God has created them to live. I've come to make you whole. And then watch what Jesus says in this next part of the story. He says to the paralytic, I tell you, get up. I wonder if this paralyzed guy has ever heard the words, get up. He's probably heard a few times, you're in the way. Get out of the way. Stop begging. Your life is worthless. But when the Son of God comes in, he speaks life into this man's soul, and he says to the core of who he is, stand up. There is more in you. There is life for you to receive. He got up in full view of them all, and this amazed everyone, and they praised God, saying, we have never seen anything like this. And here is this man who maybe he's been paralyzed from birth, is dancing and shouting and celebrating that the Son of God has given life to his soul and strength to his legs, and he's been elevated to live the life that he was created to live. But I want us to notice something about this story. Let's go back a few verses earlier, when here this man is being lowered down on the mat. In verse number 5, it says, when Jesus saw their faith. Notice that it doesn't say when Jesus saw his faith. So many other instances when there were healings from the life of Jesus, it would say when Jesus saw his or her faith, he would bring healing. But in this story, it says when Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, son, your sins are forgiven. Now, this is not a deep theological point that your faith can bring salvation to somebody else. It's simply saying that God can see in us when there is passion, when there is faith, when there is hunger, when there is desire to get people in our lives, our friends, our family members, our coworkers, our neighbors to Jesus, that God honors that faith, that he blesses that faith, and somebody down the line in your life can be transformed as a result of your faith and willingness to get that person to Jesus, the one who can bring healing, the one who can bring life to their soul. And the third group of people that we see in the story is the group of people that we will call the contagious contributors. They were the ones that recognized and took ownership for the condition of their friend's life. They said, it's not okay with us if our friend who can't walk is just a few hundred yards away from Jesus. We have to get this guy to Jesus so that he can receive and experience the healing that only Jesus can give. They took ownership. They recognized that they had the ability to do something about the problem. Instead of consuming, instead of criticizing, they contributed. I wonder if there was another instance, because Jesus had been in this town before. I wonder if there was another time where they were consumers. I wonder if there was another story where Jesus was teaching and these guys were watching. And they walked away and they're like, it's not enough for us to consume. We have to contribute. We have to be a part of this work that Jesus is doing. We have to engage in it. We have to make a difference in the life. You know, Joe over there who hasn't walked, I just saw Jesus heal somebody. He brought sight to their eyes. I just saw Jesus bring this guy back from the dead. Next time he's here, we got to get Joe to him, because we know if we get Joe to him, he's going to walk again. He's going to be changed forever. And they took ownership. You know, we have three kids. Cademan's 8, Sammy's 6, Karis is 1. We have different expectations for our children. Karis, when she was born a year ago, every single nutrient that she needed, every time she needed a diaper change, she got it, all access, like a queen, on demand, the moment she needed it. Now, over the course of time, she's transitioning to maturity, and we're expecting more and more and more and more and more that she's able to care for herself. Our 6-year-old son, he oftentimes has a runny nose, and we'll say to him, Sammy, you're responsible to wipe your nose. You're 6 years old. Mommy and daddy aren't responsible to wipe your nose anymore. Our 8-year-old son, Cademan, we expect him to be able to get himself dressed and to be able to take his clothes to the laundry room. We have different expectations for our children based upon their age and where they are. Now, if Cademan, our 8-year-old, is still sitting at a table expecting us to spoon-feed him, there's a problem there. There's an issue. And our hope is that our kids, as they grow up, they would transition to be able to be responsible for themselves, but not just be responsible for themselves, but to take ownership for the condition of their environment and to eventually come to the place where they are contributing to society and to the well-being of those around them. And if we get stuck anywhere along the way, we would say something's wrong. If you have an 8-year-old sitting at the table in diapers, something's wrong with that picture. But what happens in our journey spiritually, we love what God has done in our church, because we have people who are all different places. We have some people who are sold out, passionate, in the game. They've been following Jesus for 30 plus years. We have a lot of people, a lot of you that are exploring. You came from different religious backgrounds or different denominations, and you're just checking out this whole Jesus thing, and you're welcome in this place. But so often what happens is we come, we consume, we criticize, and we get stuck. See, contributing to the mission of Jesus is not about what we want from you. It's about what we want for you. And maturation in our lives doesn't happen if we don't switch the lens that we see our lives through to begin to see ourselves as contributors, to begin to see that I can make a difference with the life, with the gifts, with the talents, with the heart, with the relationships that God has given to me. It's not being a spiritual consumer. It's going from being a spiritual consumer to being a spiritual contributor. And this can happen the moment that you make a decision to follow Jesus. You can start to see yourself through the lens. And the way you see yourself makes all the difference whether or not you will grow at the rate that God wants you to grow. And some of us, we know theology, we have Bible verses memorized, maybe even went to seminary, but we're babes spiritually because our eyes are on ourselves, we're critics, and we're not focused on letting God use our lives to make a difference. I don't care how much Bible you know, how much theology you have, if you are not a contributor, you are not mature spiritually. And what God wants for you and for me and for all of us is to capture the beauty of what can happen in our lives and through our lives is we begin to see ourselves as contributors to his work. So I want to share with you in the few moments that we have remaining how you can do that, how you can move from the stands to the field, from consumer to contributor, from spectator to being engaged as a participant on the field. So you have a little sheet that you got inside your program that looks like this. I want to invite you to go ahead and pull that out that talks about partnership. I want to talk to you about partnership for the next few moments of how we can move from the stands to the field. See, when we started our church, we were trying to figure out the best way to help people engage. And initially, we realized that when people are on a group and on a team, they grow faster. Their lives are changed. But as we became bigger and larger as a church, it became increasingly important for us to be able to identify who's a part of this mission, who's a part of this vision, so that we can continue at a higher level of engagement to give you resources to grow faster and to create a higher level of accountability in your life to hold you to a higher standard. See, we all know that when we're held to a higher standard, we grow faster. You go to a CrossFit class, you sign up for the class, you pay your dues, and that sign up, those dues, put you in a place that you're accountable, knowing that there's going to be somebody who's calling you if you're not there for class this week. When you're sending your kids to school, it's not just a casual, you come to school when you want. There is accountability around our engagement and involvement, and the same is true spiritually. Now, there aren't dues that we have to pay spiritually, but when you are committed to a local body, a local church, something happens inside of you that we don't float from church to church to church to church, but we say, this is the local church where I'm engaged, I'm united underneath the mission and vision of this church, and I'm saying, I want this church to hold me accountable to become all that God has created me to be, and to let God use my life to make a difference in conjunction with this church, because there's no limit. When God finds a group of people that are engaged together, that are working together, God can do more through us together than he can do with any one person on their own. Last year, we had 315 people make first-time decisions to follow Jesus. That's almost one person every single day. You know, not one of us could do that on our own, but together we can accomplish that. So we're rolling out in 2015 this concept called partnership, where people identify and say, this is my local church that I'm engaged in. Now, we have four C's of partnership. Let me explain to you what this means. First of all, partners at South Bay commit to following Jesus and taking the step to publicly identify with him. Now, let me say this on the front end. You can be a part of South Bay and not be a partner. You don't have to sign on the dotted line and say, I'm a partner, to continue to come or even to be involved in groups and teams. This is just a higher level of engagement for us together. Those who are a part of partnership, though, they say, I'm committed to following Jesus with my entire life, and I'm going to let others know through baptism. So next week, We're going to have a baptism service here at both of our campuses. We're going to let people go public with their faith in Jesus. And if you've never taken that step, let's make next weekend the weekend that you go public with your faith. The first C is to commit to Jesus wholeheartedly. The second C is celebrate by pursuing a lifestyle of worship and regularly attending services. You know, a lifestyle of worship is all day long, every single day, that we make Jesus the priority and focus of our lives. But also, in addition to that, our worship happens together collectively through our weekend services. And so often what happens is we find ourselves disjointed because the busyness of life, that we can fall into this tendency where we come to church once every 6 weeks or 8 weeks or 10 weeks. And, you know, we're glad you come anytime that you come. But sometimes with a level of accountability to be more consistent, those of you who are parents, our kids need to see us in attendance, serving on a regular basis. And we're saying people who are partners at South Bay are making this commitment to celebrate regularly in our relationship with God, but collectively together as one local church, one body of believers. Number three is this. We connect with others by making life groups a part of our regular life. So life groups, they're not for life. They go semester to semester. We have three on-ramps throughout the course of the year. They're groups of 10 to 12 people. We have groups that are around interest from biking to running. We have groups that are around Bible study. We have groups that are around discussion of the weekend's message. But it's important to recognize that being in community, if you were here last week, we talked about how holding on to the rope of the right people will propel us in the right direction with our lives. And partners here at South Bay make a decision that we're going to connect with one another in the context of community through our life groups. And then number four is this. We contribute by serving in a team, giving generously, and investing in those who are far from God. By saying, I'm going to take my gifts and my talents, whether it's leading a life group, being a part of the Connection Center, serving in First Impressions, greeting at the Bay Kids' door, standing in the parking lot on our campuses. I'm going to make a decision to contribute by letting my life be used by God to work in a production booth, to stand behind a camera. I'm going to let my life be used to serve on a team here at South Bay, give generously. I'm going to prioritize my generosity financially and invest in the vision. And then finally, I'm going to let my life be used by God to invest in those who've never experienced his love. And if you just zoom out for a second and think about the magnitude, 1,500 people collectively, all engaged in letting God use our lives and contributing together. 1,500 people that are connected, 5 to 10 of us each that we're investing in. There's no limit to what God can do through our lives together if we will believe and trust God and we will move from the stands into the field. Now, I know if a disproportionate percentage of our people are on the field, it makes life a little bit messy. 22 people on the field, that's a little bit easier to manage. But we're saying today, we're willing as a church to deal with the mess for greater difference in our own personal lives and ultimately for our lives to be used by God. You know, 6 years ago, on this weekend, on a Sunday night, we gathered in a small apartment complex clubhouse. And it was our last launch team meeting. And at this launch team meeting, there were about 30 adults and 10 kids. And we gathered together just to cast the vision for launching a brand new church on February 8th, 2009. That would be called South Bay Church. And we all had this sense of expectancy and faith and hope that God would use our lives. That next Sunday, everybody who was a part of that launch team was serving and setting up pipe and drape there at 6:30 in the morning for our first service, working in Bay Kids, laying out these hundreds and hundreds of mats that had to be linked together. It was this arduous process, but we were willing to do whatever it takes to lay the groundwork right so that kids could hear the message of Jesus. And on that day, 275 people from our community showed up for the first ever South Bay Church. 30 people that gave their lives and said, God, will you use us to do something beyond what any of us could do on our own? I was praying this morning for our service, and I felt like God was saying, Andy, tell them they're a launch team. Tell them they're a launch team once again. Could you imagine that same analogy that if we all saw ourselves a part of the launch of what God wants to do to take our church to that next level of influence in our community? That if 1,500 people became our launch team around our vision, there's no limit to what God could do. people serving, people giving, people inviting and investing in their friends. And we're starting to wrestle through questions like this. What will it take over the next 10 to 15 years for us to change the entire spiritual landscape of the Bay Area? That one day, the Bay Area that's known for resistance to the message of Jesus is known for a movement of the gospel, that there is an awakening in our region that transforms the entire Bay Area, that resounds from here, that influences the rest of the globe, that one day, maybe just one day, as 50% of the world in the next few years will be connected through the internet, maybe we can be a part of and a catalyst to an entire global movement of the message of Jesus so that people who are far from God can come and receive life. Their lives can be transformed, and what happens here can emanate from here so that our community is changed and transformed. And it takes you and I being willing to say, God, will you use me? Will you use my life? Contrary to football, the difference is not talent, it's not giftedness, it's not body fat. You know, if you wanted to go play on the field today, you can't. Unless you got in that Pepsi challenge draw, you can't. Because you're not there. You're not gifted enough. But in God's economy, it's not giftedness. It's willingness. It's availability. It's you and me saying, God, my life is yours. Will you use me? So here's what I want to ask of you. I want to ask you today to become a partner at South Bay. Pull out your connection card just for a moment right now. And on the back of your connection card, you can write down this phrase, I commit to become a South Bay partner. And simply today, by writing down this phrase, you can become a partner of our church and lock arms with us around the mission and vision that God has given to us. Now, I know for some of you, you don't make fast decisions. You need to go back and process and pray through. That's cool. You need to go talk to your spouse and decide, or you need to wrestle through individually. That's cool. Just email me by the end of the week at awood@southbaychurch and let me know if you've made a decision to be a partner. From this point forward, we're going to shift gears, and every other month, we're going to do a partnership workshop where people who decide to be partners go through this workshop before they make the decision to engage. And we're saying today, we're rolling it out. We're going to make it as easy as possible, remove as many barriers as possible to say you can identify and say, I'm a part of this church and a part of the vision that God has given to South Bay to make a difference in Silicon Valley and beyond. One last story, and then I'll wrap it up. This last week, I sat down in my office with the family who had just recently lost their father. Jose Sr. just passed away, and his son, Jose Jr., and Lupe, Jose's wife, sat in my office to plan Jose Sr.'s memorial service. A couple years ago, Jose Jr. started coming to South Bay, and on one Sunday, we had this opportunity at our North San Jose campus for people to come forward and write the names of friends and family members on the wall as a way of saying, I'm praying, God, would you use my life to influence this person? Jose Jr. comes forward and he writes down Lupe's name on the board, on the wall, asking God to use him to bring her to South Bay so that her and his father would be transformed. He invites them. They start coming. Very quickly, they realize that this is going to become the church where they're going to plant themselves, and over the next several months, God begins to change both Jose Sr. and Lupe's life, to the point that one Sunday after a service, Jose Sr. comes up and says to me, Andy, I got cancer, I've been declared terminally ill, and 6 months from now, my life is over, and I need you to help me die well. Could you imagine that conversation, and what he must have felt in that moment? And over the next several months, we would have conversations, and I watched as this man's countenance changed to go to hope, peace, and life, and trust, knowing that one day, shortly, he would stand before the King of all kings and Lord of all lords with confidence he could face his eternity. You know, this is not just a game. It's not just commercials and trying to make it all run smoothly. It's an eternal battle that we are in as a church for the hearts and souls of the people around us. In our community, our church, God's mission is requiring us to give everything that we have. And I make no apologies that as we engage together, both you personally and us together, we experience greater growth than we ever will on our own. And there is no limit to what God can do through a group of people that are fully bought into his vision. Scripture says, not to him who is able to do immeasurably more than you and I could ever ask or imagine according to his power that is at work within us. And God is wanting today to do immeasurably more, and he's asking you to take that shift from the stands into the field, from consumer to contributor, from spectator to participant, to watch him use your life and grow you in ways that you've never experienced before. Let's pray together. Jesus, thank you that you give us the privilege of being a part of your work, that you give us the privilege of seeing you grow our hearts and our lives. We pray now that you would use this message to help us take the step to shift from the stands to the field and get in the game with the mission and vision you've given to our church. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.